I would like to see in 10 years tools that would allow even a biologist who has no prior expertise in chip design to be able to bring to life their new idea in silicon. The problem I'm most excited about right now is the use of machine learning to improve the efficiency of chip design, to allow people to design chips faster, better, higher quality chips. There's a huge opportunity to use large language models and reinforcement learning to enable this goal. So we started looking at this problem a couple of years back. This is with my colleague, Professor Ramesh Curry, and one of my PhD students, Animesh Chowdhury. Our interest in this space has since grown exponentially, and so we have multiple students now looking broadly at the problem of machine learning for chip design. There are computer chips, as I'm sure all of you are aware, inside pretty much every modern electronics product. So your mobile phone has a chip inside it, in fact, many chips. Your laptop has many chips inside it, your camera. But these chips are actually incredibly complex. I would argue that computer chips are probably one of the most complex engineered products that humanity has ever produced. And as a consequence, designing a chip is extremely time-consuming, extremely resource-intensive, requires hundreds of experts with tens of years of experience in this area. And so the problem that we are really trying to solve is, how can I reduce this incredibly complex, painful, cumbersome design process? And this is where machine learning can play a role, not in reducing the number of developers and designers, but really to enable designers to make more secure, more efficient, less power hungry chips that can have a significant impact on our economy. The problem is challenging because it's heavily interdisciplinary. You need expertise in machine learning, you need expertise in hardware, expertise in chip design, and you need to put all of these ideas together to come up with good solutions. I find myself to be ideally suited to solve these types of problems because I got my PhD doing chip design, and then I spent the last decade looking at machine learning and AI, and both these skill sets are of massive value in solving these problems. So more concretely, what we're trying to do is we're trying to attack the problem on multiple fronts. We've trained the first large language model. We call that large language model Verigen, that is explicitly tailored to generating the kind of code that is used to design computer chips. The second front is, once you have code that specifies what a chip should do, even taking that code and then synthesizing it into a mask that you can send to a foundry for production is extremely time consuming. So we are also trying to use machine learning to reduce time to market and have a push button solution that takes a specification of a chip and then converts it into a mask that can be shipped off and fabricated without significant designer effort and time. More technically, we're using reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning is the super cool machine learning technique that's been used, for example, in developing the world's best Go player, the world's best chess player. So we're using those types of methods to improve the quality of chip design. The most recent update in our research is a tool that we call ChipChat. We recently published that paper at a conference called Machine Learning for CAD. What ChipChat is a dialogue interface that allows a designer to have a dialogue with a modern machine learning tool. So the developer, the designer of the chip, is actually only talking to the tool in English, saying, oh, I want my chip to do X. I would like for it to consume at most 2 watts of power. And in the back end, our solution is actually taking the designer's instruction feedback to actually improve the quality of the design.
The reason that we think that ChipChat is so groundbreaking in a sense is because it really goes to show, as a very concrete proof of concept of what AI is capable of doing right now. This is not sort of something that, oh, you know, in 6 months we'll be able to do this, or in 6 years we'll be able to do this. You know, 2 months ago we essentially designed a chip using AI and sent that chip to fabrication.
Something I'm also interested in is workforce development. I would like to see in 10 years tools that would allow even a biologist who has no prior expertise in chip design to be able to bring to life their new idea in silicon. And that's going to require us to remove, or at least reduce, the barrier to entry. Right now, chip design is considered a very obscure, difficult to acquire skill. And I want to use machine learning tools to make it easier for people who don't have domain expertise to be able to pick up the skill and design chips, creating new innovations, new inventions in domains that go far outside the traditional reach of hardware. I'm part of the organizing committee of a conference called Machine Learning for CAD. CAD stands for computer-aided design. In this context, computer-aided design of electrical chips. So MLCAD is essentially a growing community of researchers who are interested in this problem. NYU is deeply embedded within this research community, and we want to continue to grow it. So I envision in 5 years that MLCAD will be one of the leading venues, high impact venues in this area. We are super excited to participate in this community and continue to grow it. Outside of research, something that matters to me a lot is to train the next generation of researchers. I would like to train my PhD students, the master's students, and undergraduates that I work with to be creative thinkers, to be problem solvers. Right now, they're looking at specific problems, but I want to give them the skills to look at any problem and come up with solutions, creative solutions to address the problem. I also would like to make sure that my group is as diverse as possible, brings in people from all types of different backgrounds, because that's what promotes creativity and creates a fun environment. So, you know, I always view research as a step in the right direction. I don't view problems as fully unsolved or fully solved. There are always rooms to make improvements, to come up with cool, creative new ideas, to solve problems that maybe people in the past thought had been solved. So in that sense, I think there's a lot of really interesting work to be done going forward.